Thank you so much, Joan and Lynn and Myron and Linda. We are blessed with wonderful music here, and I'm always happy to have them here. Well, good morning and happy Sabbath to you all. Are you glad to be here on this beautiful day in this cooler church as compared to how hot it is outside? I am really happy and grateful to be here right now. I'm moving tomorrow, not out of the city, just neighborhoods. I'm moving from the lower Nob Hill area to the outer Richmond area, and the van is coming tomorrow morning around 8 o'clock, and I still haven't finished packing yet. I have been completely stressed out for the last couple of weeks, which makes me so grateful for the Sabbath and to be here. But there's that part of me that's saying, gee, I wish I didn't have to get up and go to church. You know, I really need to be home and finish my packing. After all, the truck is coming. Why do I have to come to church every week anyway? You know, in some churches, they only go, the majority of them, only a couple of times a year, you know, Christmas and Easter. What's the point? Do I really have to, after all? My salvation is based on my personal relationship with God, right? What's the point of coming together anyway? And if I miss a week, you know, for whatever reason, I mean, we have this wonderful technology. We have, you know, the services on the internet. You can check it out on the website. It's like, if I miss something, it's great. And I love this because it's true. We do miss things from time to time. And it's so wonderful that we have this modern technology that can reach all over the world. But does that mean we forsake the fellowship of other believers? Is there a reason why we gather together and worship? What is this thing called worship anyway, and what's it all about? I decided to look it up. I went to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, and under there it said worship, expression of reverence toward God. It also says extravagant respect or admiration for or devotion to an object of esteem. Worshiping is called to perform or take part in worship. Under Roget's College Thesaurus, it says worship, adoration, devotion, aspiration, homage, revere. Now, those all sound really, really good. So that's one thing here. There's also the fact that when we were created, God created us not only to have a relationship with Him, but to worship and fellowship with Him and with each other. We're not in a vacuum. We're supposed to fellowship. We were not meant to be alone. He wanted us to get together and be a part of the experience of being with God. In fact, it's interesting how in a prison system, the worst punishment they can dole out is isolation. The fact is, that's what makes people go crazy, and it's the hardest thing, is to be isolated. We need each other. No man is an island, etc., etc. But it's also been said that because we were created with this need, that we have this void, that if we need to worship, if we don't have a God to worship, we will find something else to worship because we have this need to worship. And we see this all over. The need people will worship either other people, things, or themselves. These other things become the objects of their esteem, adoration, or love. And I would like to look at one of those phenomena today that we regard today known as fandom. We see this as a fan of sports events, entertainment events, following well-known celebrities or royalty or politicians, whatever. There are people that are fans and will end up worshiping and adore these individuals or groups. Now, again, in the dictionary, a fan was known as an enthusiastic follower, admirer of a sport or entertainment. The Vesarius says a fan is a devotee, follower, enthusiast, supporter, rooter, addict. Then also there was a little sort of footnote, see amusement. Then I looked under amusement, and it had all kinds of definitions from amusement, anywhere from a pleasant diversion to a labor of love. There is a whole spectrum of what is involved in being a fan. So what do fans do? Well, sports fans, have any of you been following the World Series? There are many people that will follow the World Series. They are such fans, but they often won't just sit and watch it alone on television, and the same with football and other big sports events. They like to get together with groups, get, you know, two or three, five or six, have maybe a party, a Super Bowl party, a World Series party, and it's great fun. You get together, you get your snacks, and you get your outfits. You know, you can have the cap or a scarf or a sweatshirt or something, and you can root for your favorite team. And it's great to do that. But it's more fun when it's shared with someone else. And of course, your more devoted fans actually go to the games. If it's in town, some for them, it's only if it's convenient. We'll go when it's convenient, if we can, if the tickets aren't too expensive, if it isn't too long to drive or whatever. There are people that will fly all over the United States to attend a sports event. There's an individual I saw on television that is in the NFL Hall of Fame, and he's a fan. He's the only fan to be in the Hall of Fame. He's not a player. And why is that? He hasn't missed a home game for Notre Dame in over 16 years. Rain or shine, snow, sleet, blizzard, he is there. And they interviewed him, and I saw the picture of him, and of course he had the whole outfit on for his favorite team. That's devotion. That is a fan. Another phenomenon we have in the entertainment world, we have Halloween coming up, for example. There was a little grade B campy film made in Hollywood a while back called The Rocky Horror Picture Show. Some of you have heard of it. There has become a huge cult following of this film. No one thought it was going to do much. It wasn't meant to be much of anything. But for some reason, it really caught on with a segment of the population where they go every Saturday night to the midnight showing of the Rocky Horror Picture Show in their local theater. I mean every Saturday night. They did a 20-year retrospective. They interviewed a guy who's seen the film over 1,000 times. 1,000 times. There are 52 weeks in a year, and we're not talking about renting the video and watching it at home. This is going to the midnight showing and watching this film. And not just watching, this phenomena has taken on a persona all its own that was started by a few fans. They started coming and dressing as the characters. Pretty soon, a script developed where they all began to participate in the event. There are places where you throw rice, and places where you light lighters, and places where you spray things, and there are places where you say things at the screen. Now, what's happening on the screen isn't going to affect what's on the screen because it's already been done. But they all participate, and they do this religiously. Can any of you say that you've gone 1,000 times in the last how many, 20 years to church every single week? It's being a fan that important? This is something that's so important. It's caught on to this segment of society that is the disenfranchised. They go there and it feeds something in their soul. Now, I'm not saying that you should now run out and go attend the Rocky Horror Picture Show. In fact, there are elements of that picture that is really not something that we should see. It's not called horror for nothing. There are some pretty horrible elements to it. But what is it about this that feeds these people and all of these disenfranchised and others that become such fans, this need that they have to be filled? Another one was a phenomenon we've seen over the last 30 years has been the Star Trek phenomenon, the Trekkies. I was a Trekkie, I must confess, in high school. I went to the conventions. You know, I didn't dress up, but I did go. And people will become so devoted where they, you know, wear the ears and wear all of this stuff to the point of where people look at them and say, why don't you people grow up and get lives? You seem to be so devoted to this. It's just a TV show. But they had this need. They needed this void filled. And this was filling it. So this is one of the things that fans do. There's active participation. Isn't there something special about being there as opposed to just watching it? It is wonderful that we have this technology that we can see, listen to something on the radio or watch it on television or click onto it on the internet. I was so grateful when we had camp meeting broadcast here via satellite. But you know, there was that part of me that wanted to be there. It wasn't the same as actually being there and being part of that group. There's something special that happens when we come together and participate as a group, the fellowship, where two or three are gathered together, God is there with us, and we can share the experience. The sharing then also goes beyond just the attending of the event. There's the water cooler talk at work. Did you see the game last night? Boy, what a shot. Did you see Barry Bonds hit that home run? Or did you see that guy fumble that pass? And that can go on for quite some time. It can also extend to popular television events. Who shot JR? Will Luke and Laura ever get together? And then, of course, politics. What's going on in our city? What was with the supervisor in electing those people? You know, we end up talking about this stuff, sharing it with people we know at work. The other thing that fans do is they will sacrifice for what they are fans to. We find it hard to go to church sometimes. We've had a long, tough week. We do. Our lives are so busy, and often I know I just want the Sabbath as a day of rest. Stay in bed, rest up. I really need it physically, emotionally, etc. But fans will sacrifice for what they are fans of. People, when they want to buy tickets, often will sleep for 3 days in line, waiting for tickets to go on sale to attend a game. If you want to go to the Rose Bowl parade, New Year's Day, we used to do this when I grew up in Southern California. You go the night before and sleep on the street in order to get a good spot to watch the parade. Now, you could stay at home and watch the parade on television in the comfort of your own home, but it's not the same as being there. And of course, it became this huge block party. You know, everybody got involved, and it became this really, really fun event. We will sacrifice for what we want badly enough. Regardless of how busy our lives are, that which is important to us, we will make time for. Even if it's recreation, if it's a round of golf, whatever it is, we will find time for that which is important. So, what is it about us not necessarily being that excited about coming to church and being a fan for Jesus? Is Jesus that important in our lives? Is he something we talk about? Now, often there's also the idea that, you know, you don't want to be forcing it on someone who really doesn't want to hear about it. And there are places where people, there's religious intolerance, and they have to have their beliefs in secret. They will, hide their Bibles under the mattress, like I used to do with my fan magazines when I was growing up, that I didn't want anyone to know. Sometimes you're a fan in secret. You have to be. But other times, you can't help it. If you're a fan, you're a fan. You can't help but talk about it. And people get, oh, there she goes again, on and on about that Star Trek people. I mean, what is it with her? Get a life. Well, that was the life. Isn't that the way it should be with our Christian experience? Shouldn't we be fans for Jesus? Also, the fact is that when we sacrifice for something, it means more to us. Perhaps the fact that God has made it as easy as possible means we take it for granted. If we had to work for it harder, wouldn't it mean more? I've heard this talked about in seminars where they will charge sometimes exorbitant amounts of money for people to attend a seminar, not because they really need the money so badly, but they know that if the people put that much money up front, they're serious. They want their money's worth, and they're going to get something out of it. If it were free, they may come, but it may not mean as much because it's free. It's too easy. But if you're willing to sacrifice for it, then it means something. There was an event that I attended, a theatrical event with my sister some years ago. She got tickets ahead of time. We were going to spend like a whole weekend, and everything went wrong. The plane was delayed. She went to pick me up at the airport, and they were renovating the airport, so they had misdirected people, and so where she tried to meet me at the gate was the wrong place, and it took us about an hour to find each other there. Then we got in the car, and the directions were given to her incorrectly on how to get to the hotel we were staying in. We finally get there, run upstairs, change clothes, dash over to the theatrical event, got there in time to sit down, hug each other, and the curtain went up. It was literally that much time. We went through quite a bit to get to this event, to the point where my sister was just in tears because we just didn't think we were going to make it in time. But we did, and it became this wonderful bonding experience. I've never forgotten it. It became one of the best things that happened in our lives together, and that we shared this special moment. Now, there are special events that we can all look to for that. But think of the devoted fan who goes to a home game, every single home game for 20 years. Think of the fans that support their teams, whether they're doing well or doing poorly. There are those that don't support a team well if they're not playing well. There are others. There's a baseball team where they haven't won the pennant since the 1930s, but they still have devoted fans that go every single home game. Shouldn't that be what our Christian experience is? Aren't we fans for Jesus? Don't we get excited about what he has done for us in our lives? Think about, too, what fans have in their homes and on their walls, that which is important to them, be it pennants and banners, posters of their favorite rock star or leading man or woman or team or whatever. I know we sometimes are so afraid of the idolatry aspect, we're afraid to put up religious icons for fear that we will get into the idolatry part, but I don't think that when God said this in the commandments that he meant us to forsake that altogether. After all, many of us are visually oriented people, and it often helps to have something around just to remind us. The people in Jesus' day even had threads woven into their clothing that had religious significance to remind them. They wore these little prayer shawls to remind them to think about and pray about God during the day. Now, we don't necessarily need to be fanatical. One of the definitions of a fanatic is marked or moved by excessive enthusiasm and intense, uncritical devotion. We don't necessarily need to go that far. After all, God wants us to be reasonable. Come, let us reason together, says the Lord. But he does want us to get together and worship. And as we study and as we improve our relationship with God, we will become excited about what he has done for us. We can't wait to share it. We don't have to have someone up here on the pulpit telling us, oh, we need to be out witnessing, we need to be out telling people. You can't share what you don't have. But if God has spoken to you and touched you, you can't help but share that the wonderful good news of what God has done for you. So I encourage all of you this morning that if you're a fan of Jesus Christ, to become more devoted. So much of what is done for us, God does it all. But our little part can be our coming to God, our willingness to do what it takes to at least be willing to be open to him. A quote from Steps to Christ of Ellen G. White is, "Who has the heart? With whom are your thoughts? Of whom do we love to converse? who has our warmest affections and our best energies? Shouldn't it be Jesus in our lives? Let us know.